Muslims came into contact with a body of knowledge which had been ignored by most of Northern Europe for centuries. The works of the ancient Greeks.
It's once you look at a globe that it becomes particularly easy to understand why the Arabs were such natural inheritors of Greek learning. From the Bronze Age onwards, there'd been a constant exchange of artifacts and information all across the Eastern Mediterranean. And in fact, a number of Greek ideas stem from Eastern and Egyptian influences. The bulk of this knowledge was preserved in the great schools and library at Alexandria. And then in 641 AD, the Arabs take over the city and at a stroke have direct access to this precious learning.
Many of these texts found their way to Fez. This is an Arabic translation of Aristotle with an additional commentary by the Muslim scholar Averroes.
The translation is done in Iraq and then Averroes does this commentary in Al-Andalus.
There's even an early Arabic translation of the Bible.
So it's extraordinary, isn't it, that Arabic's the lingua franca, and everybody's writing in Arabic, even the Bible.
And thus ends the Gospel of Mark the Apostle.
The contrast with Europe at this time could not have been greater. Here, ancient Greek texts and the rational investigation they contained were often feared as blasphemous.
When the Prophet Muhammad was born, Christianity had already been battling with paganism for 600 years. Trying to persuade believers to turn away from their old gods to the one new god. And because of that, Christians were often suspicious of Greek and Roman pagan texts. For instance, in 529 AD, the Christian emperor Justinian closed down the Athenian schools of philosophy.
Set against this vibrant Islamic culture, Europe can appear an introspective and intellectually cautious place. It was certainly a continent in crisis.
After the fall of Rome, there was a power vacuum in Europe, with rival tribes squabbling for territories. It was the start of what later Christian scholars would describe as the Dark Ages.
While Europe lay unprotected and vulnerable, Islam was consolidating land and power. By the beginning of the 8th century, the Arabs had converted the Berber tribes at the very tip of North Africa. And before long, troops were gathered on the coast, their eyes fixed on Europe.
This little stretch of water between Spain and Morocco is only 9 miles wide, but it's come to represent some kind of cultural chasm between Europe and Africa. But in the 8th century, when sea travel was the way to get around, that wasn't a barrier, it was a highway.
In July 711, 7,000 Berber tribesmen stormed across the Straits of Gibraltar and invaded Europe. The Muslims then began an incredible process of expansion. In just 4 years, they'd colonized almost the whole of Spain, had crossed the Pyrenees, and were only halted at Poitiers in France. Were it not for this reverse, an army which had swept across two continents might easily have crossed the English Channel and occupied Britain. The Muslims called the country they came to Al-Andalus, the land of the Vandals. This refers to the Germanic tribe who ruled Spain at the time, the Visigoths. Spanish historians have traditionally seen the Muslim invasion of Spain as a terrible and violent attack, an assault on Christian Europe. In fact, here at the Visigothic site of Rocopolis near Madrid, archaeologists have found evidence which offers a rather different explanation.
The city of Recopolis, in fact, was the royal city founded by the Visigoths in order to demonstrate the power of the new state. Dimensions were spectacular for this period. And this complex is the most important discovery in Western Europe.
What was it at the time that the Muslims were invading? Well, what was the state of the city then?
They found it not only here in this part of Iberia, but in everywhere of the Al-Andalus. They found it cities in crisis. Social crisis, of urban crisis. The traditional explanation is this idea that when the Arabs came, the society collapses and the city collapses. It's not true. It's not true. The collapse of the city started during the Visigothic period.
If you read the Orthodox Spanish histories, then you'll learn that predatory Muslim hordes forcibly appropriated Visigothic Spain. And there certainly were some invasion battles. But at many places, like here at Recopolis, it seems that the newcomers were actually welcomed with open arms. We even have treaties where the Visigoths enthusiastically hand over their land in return for effective Muslim protection. When you were excavating, did you find any evidence of violence at the time of the Arab invasion?
We don't have evidence of violence. Not at all. In this area was peaceful, and the archaeology is showing another landscape, no? Another explanation too. The Muslims started to build a new society.
The enthusiasm for learning that the Islamic world had spent years nurturing was about to be transmitted to Europe.
We went into Spain not to fight against the people there, but to save them from the tyranny of the Latins and others that governed them at the time. In Al-Andalus, they found a paradise on earth. When the Arabs changed location, changed geography from their inhospitable, barren homeland, and moved to a rich and fertile country, this was to transform the Arab mind. This is the secret of how such a great civilization came to be born.
The foundations of a new society had been laid. A self-confident, progressive and sophisticated civilization had arrived among the failing states of Europe. And the continent's history was about to be transformed. The Muslim invasion of Spain had been swift and effective, but it lacked a strong leadership. The first wave of invaders were North African tribesmen, only recently converted to Islam, and without connections to the power base of Arabia. But this was about to change. In the capital of the Muslim world, a political coup left all the members of the ruling dynasty massacred. All, that is, except for one, a prince called Abd al-Rahman.
Abd al-Rahman was in his late teens when his family was massacred. He managed to escape the slaughter and fled to the hills west of Damascus.
His mother had been from North Africa, and Abd al-Rahman must have grown up hearing tales of Al-Andalus. And so he made a dangerous journey across the Nile and the deserts of Egypt, heading for those distant lands. Abd al-Rahman brought culture and learning from the center of the Islamic world straight to the heart of Al-Andalus.
When Abd al-Rahman arrived in Spain, he came here to Cordoba, where the city was in complete disarray. That Roman bridge had collapsed into the river. But Abd al-Rahman set to rebuilding the city. You have to remember that it's in this context that the Arabs arrive, not as marauding destroyers, but sometimes as saviours.
Abd al-Rahman brought cutting-edge technology for irrigation to Spain. Almost immediately, the landscape was transformed. Palm trees, lemon and orange groves, avocados, artichokes and pomegranates, none of which had been seen in Europe. Because of Abd al-Rahman's sophisticated trade network, this new agriculture created huge wealth.